So this morning when I got dressed, I always like to run everything by Olivia and put the vest on. My first option was a vest with no shirt. For some reason she said no. That was a joke. So we have a new app, okay? I'm going to dismiss all the kids so Dennis will quit waving and pointing at me like I'm some kind of. Dismiss all the kids. Be blessed. We love you. Depart. So we have a new app, and I just want to talk about the app a little bit because there's a reason why we have an app. It's not just like today's generation. This is the language of today's generation. Like everything's about, you know, and many of you are finding this out as, you know, you're trying to keep up, right? And I know because I often get phone calls from my mother or my father, and they're like, how do you do this? It's like, you guys are old already. But apps are part of how we reach the next generation. It's the language of the generation. And so we put together this app, and I really want to thank Greg. He really spearheaded it and put a lot of time and effort. So, you know, I'm sure there'll be some bugs that we have to work out along the way, but the idea with the app is you can go there. It has everything about Cheers. You can watch the services there, and it's just a neat piece of technology that we just want to try to somehow keep up with as we, and that's something we've always felt with Cheers, is try to keep doing things. There's no reason why, just because we're a small church, we still can't try to do and use technology. And so I just really, again, I really appreciate Greg and all his hard work on that. And that's where we're at. I have another announcement to make. My daughter has taken to calling me Kenny Boy. Like, I don't know how three-year-olds, how their minds work, but so the other day she's like, okay, Kenny Boy. Like, and she's been doing this, and I'm like, what are Kenny Boy? Like, she's like, well, Barbie has Ken, and so you're my Kenny Boy. And so, if from now on, if you could address me as Kenny Boy, I'd appreciate it. That was also a joke. Please do not start addressing me as Kenny Boy. But on a more, I don't want to say serious, but more real note. I became full-time with the church this summer with the idea of running it through the summer, and then we would see how things unfolded. I was also offered a job at the prison, the new prison. And so I've decided to take that job at the prison. And I'm really excited about it. And it's something I've really had to wrestle with because back in my day, when I was still young, I actually worked in a church full-time before. And when we started Cheers so many moons ago, the dream was, in my mind, was always, oh, one day, you know, I want to go back full-time pastoring. But there's been a lot that's happened in my life in the last 10 years. And it really starts to change you, is change your priorities, change what you're looking for, change what you, even your dreams and your desires along the way. And so this summer has been great. I've been able to do some things, and I really appreciate that. But when I sat back and just really thought about it and what my ministry looks like and what God's doing in my life and through my life, the idea of going to prison was something that just kept exciting me and I just couldn't get away from. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go work at the prison full time. And well, I expected a little few, you know, I didn't expect you guys to stand up and applaud me for going. Like, oh, great, he's leaving. Woo, yes, thank you, Jesus. Yeah, I'm leaving. I'm leaving now. So, but what I'm really excited about is that as a church, we've never had this opportunity and the ability, even financially, that we do now to really bring someone in that can bring a specific skill set to the table. Dennis and I, we have a lot of the same skill sets. I mean, they are awesome, incredible skill sets, but they are a lot of the same skill sets. And so this really gives us the opportunity to bring in a pastor that has those skill sets that can really bring an added strength to the church. And so we are in the process of doing that. And I don't know who he or she may be, but we're really excited about that. And I would ask you just be praying about that, that God would bring the right person in. As far as for me, they've already told me I'm going to be in records. I'm going to be Monday to Friday. So it doesn't really change a lot of your interaction with me. I'll still be here every Sunday. I'll still be doing what I do, what I've always done for the last 10 years, where I worked and I served the church. And so that doesn't change. And so it's not like you're losing us. You aren't getting rid of us. We're still going to be around. But we just can bring an extra strength to the church. So it's a good thing. And we're excited about what God has for us and what's coming for here at Cheers. One of the requirements of any new person that we bring in is the ability to really do announcements. We really feel like that has really always held us back. And once again, as Dennis demonstrated this morning, we need help. So with that all of the way, I am here to preach this morning. The title of my message this morning is The What of Cheers. The What of Cheers, connecting people, encountering God, declaring destiny. When we did our church evaluation with Justin back in the fall, I think it was the fall, it seemed like it was a while ago. And one of the things that he really pointed out to us that was a weakness as a church was a lack of a solid mission statement. So this last summer, that's kind of what I really want to try to flesh that out. I mean, we have a natural, what's the word I'm looking for? There's just a naturalness of who we are. You know, that's just our flavor, our just what has been developed here. But just to really kind of flesh that out and put it in something that people can easily identify, embrace, and remember. And so, you know, we wanted something that spoke about what we already were, but in a simple statement. And I'm hoping that you've noticed already this statement, because it's something that we want you to know, and it's something that you need to know. This idea of connecting people, encountering God, declaring destiny. See, the idea behind a mission statement is that it keeps us on mission. That it helps lead us. It helps to guide us as a church so that we know what we are about. We know what we are doing. And it has to be more, you know, it's more than just a catchy saying. It tells us what we are about. So it has to be more than just what we pay lip service to. It has to be more than something that you can just spout off. But it really has to, it's something that we embrace and really speaks to who we are. Something that we take to heart. And so I want to bring to the forefront this morning, and just to give clarity to it, to give definition to it, to put some real meaning to it, so that it becomes more than something that you read on a wall. And it helps you understand And to help you understand, is Cheers the place for you, number one? Because you need to know that. Like, is this the place where I want to invest my life into? Is what we're about, does that resonate in me? So number one, is Cheers the place for you? And number two, then what is your role? What's your part in what Cheers is about? See, and this is something we need to understand. Mission only works if people are on board. We can have the greatest mission in the world, but if there's no buy-in, then it's just empty words. It's us. It's you. It's me deciding that this is worth my time, my effort, my finances. This is worth my investment. That of all the options that you have, of all the things you could do with your time, your life, your resources, that you would be willing to place the mission of Cheers in your priorities. And honestly, if you don't believe in the mission, then that's good too. Because then you know Cheers isn't for you. Like honestly, as a pastor, one of the hardest things for me is lukewarm commitment. Never knowing if someone's with you or not, if you can count on them, if they mean what they say or if it's just empty words. And so we really want to bring clarity so that you know, like, yeah, you know what? I believe in this. This is something that I really believe in, that I want to be part of. And if you look at it, you go, you know what? No. Then that's great too. Then you're like, you know what? That's fine. this isn't my place. And, you know, I get it. If you're new to your faith and you're just trying to figure out everything and you know, you aren't totally bought into anything yet because you're just trying to understand the whole Christianity thing. But if you're a mature Christian, there's a problem if you can't commit. And as I said, maybe the fact is Cheers isn't for you. And maybe at the end of this message, you'll be like, no, I don't believe in this mission. It doesn't fit me. And that's okay too. But then you have a responsibility as a mature Christian to engage somewhere else. See, the Bible makes it very clear that as Christians, we all need the body. We all need the body. I know there's a lot of people out there in this day and age that talk about, you know, that they can be a Christian without going to church. And that's, you know, it's, I still have my faith, and it's me and Jesus, and it sounds all so kumbayash. You know, I go out in the mountains and I have this encounter with God. And you know, I don't know if that's totally scriptural. As Christians, I fully believe we need the body. And the church is the body of believers. Hebrews 10, 24, 25 says, and let's consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as it is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Romans 12, 5 says, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. 1 Corinthians 12, 12 says, just as a body, though one, may have many parts, but all its parts form one body, so it is with Christ. Ephesians 3, 10 says, his intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. The church plays a vital role. We, being part of the church, play a vital role. So as Christians, not being in regular fellowship is contrary to the word of God. And I'm preaching to the choir here this morning. You're all in church. You can all give yourself a pat on the back and go, oh, I'm so glad I came this morning. But it needs to be a priority in your life, whether it's at Cheers or somewhere else. See, what I've learned is that there's always an excuse not to go. It's always easy to find some reason. But when you think about the history of the church, what the disciples went through to establish the church, how they suffered, how they gave their lives, you have to come to the conclusion that the church is established by God, and it is incredibly important. You read about Paul, how he went around and set up churches and how he was beaten and persecuted and how disciples died for this idea of starting churches. Church is important. If they would give their life for it, it speaks to how God values it. It's not something to be easily dismissed or taken for granted. Colossians 1:24. Now, this is Paul speaking. Now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is lacking in regards to Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, which is the church. Paul suffered for the church. So you need church. You need to commit to a church. You need to engage in a church. And the church, on the other hand, has a responsibility to be on mission. The church has to have a focus. The church needs to be about something. And so this morning, that's what I want to present to you is what is the mission of Cheers and what it looks like, and just really so that you can really have an understanding. So it starts with connecting people. I feel like, especially in this last year, like God has had me preach a lot about relationships and the importance of loving each other. And I know I've said it many times that ministry starts with love, that we're called to love each other. That it's more important than our spiritual giftedness, that it's more important than any talent we might possess, it's more important than our title or office. It's the foundation to be a Christian. We are called to love each other, to serve each other, to value each other. This is, in essence, what connecting people means. That we need to be a place of relationship. That people can come through these doors and find healthy relationships. That we would go and build healthy relationships with people around us. See, at Cheers, relationships are important. We have to be more than a bunch of strangers singing a few songs together, you know, every other Sunday. We are tasked with caring for each other. We are tasked with supporting each other. We are tasked with loving each other. And that's gonna be hard at times. I'm not gonna lie. I heard it said one time, if you wanna, that connecting with people is about building bridges, about being a bridge, sorry. And the problem with being a bridge is you get walked on. Relationships are hard, messy work. They take time, they take effort, they take going beyond yourself, they take not being appreciated, they take not always being received. Rick Warren says it like this: love cannot be learned in isolation. You have to be around people, irritating, imperfect, frustrating people. Don't look at your spouse right now. And if the last 10 years has taught me anything, it's hard to have relationships. And there are times, I will admit, I shy away from them because of the effort it takes, because life already seems busy enough. But the problem for me, and you know, this God always does this to me. I see something and I kind of want to stay away from it. That doesn't really, you know, it's kind of discomforting and it's kind of irritating. But then God always has a way of bringing it back to his word. And then I find in his word that what I like doesn't always line up with what God says. And then I'm faced with this task of what am I going to do with this? Because if you believe that the Bible is the word of God, then the only option is for you to change. I can't change the word, so that means I have to change. I don't like changing me. I'm very comfortable with me. But as the Bible points out, the whole point of Christianity is relationship. That God so desired relationship with us that he pursued us. See, it wasn't enough for God to stay at a distance, just observing and watching humanity. But he sent his son into our world at our level to connect with us. God made it personal. He made it personal for every one of us. And listen to how Jesus backs us up in Mark 12, verse 28. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked of him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandments greater than these." Like, Jesus doesn't give a lot of wiggle room here. He doesn't say, well, you know, you can pick your top 10. These are the top 10. And he said, these are the top two of the top 10. These are the most important. That this is it right here. It's all found in these two commandments. Because the reality is, if you take everything else away and you just follow these two, you're good to go. You can take away the whole Bible and just if you based your life just simply on these two commandments, you'd be in good shape. See, if love is your foundation, you're not going to murder. If love is your foundation, you're not going to steal from somebody. If love is your foundation, you're not going to lie to people you love. You can do away with the other eight commandments, and if you actually just focused on these two, you'd be okay. And so Jesus said, this is the most important thing. Love. Love your neighbor as yourself. Relationship. You can't have love without relationship. And so here at Cheers, we want to be about connecting with people. Now understand, that doesn't mean the pastor is connecting with everybody. That means you. If you decide that, yeah, you know what, I believe in the mission of Cheers, then when you look and you say connecting people, it's on you. You have a responsibility to connect, to go beyond yourself, to build relationships, to invite people over to your house, even if it's not clean. to take part in the potlucks, to join a small group as we work towards that this fall, launching those, to go to coffee with someone, to not just run out the door at the end of the service. Yes, you actually have to talk to people that have relationship. To at the minimum greet a new person when they come through the doors. And let me just put you at rest here. It is true. There will be times where it feels very awkward. Get over yourself. Oh, you know, I'm not really outgoing, and it's so uncomfortable, and I don't know what to say. Get over yourself. Like you just go and you do it. Hi, how are you?
Good, Joe. How are you?
Nice to see you. I'm so glad you're here. Are you new to town?
No.
Oh, great. Great. So do you work?
Yes, I do.
Oh, what do you do?
I work at the shelter.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. That must be a really challenging job.
Oh, it is.
I believe it. I heard the boss down there. I heard he's a little bit.
He's yeah.
Yes, that's what I've heard. Okay, well, great. Well, welcome to Cheers. So happy you're here today.
Thank you.
You know, help yourself. You want a coffee or tea or something? All right. You know, like we can all do that. And that's just part of connecting with people. It's on us this morning. It's on, you know, we all have that responsibility. If you're saying, yeah, you know, I want to be part of Cheers, then that's on you. You can't just come and be a wallflower and try to hide. No, because we're saying this is who we are. So you have to push yourself at times. You're going to be awkward at times. You know, some people already probably find you awkward. I hate to break it to you. You know, I mean, it's okay. And yes, relationships take two, but someone has to initiate. Someone has to be willing to go beyond their comfort. You know, every person, I was thinking about this, every person I've ever led to the Lord has been in a relationship. And generally, it's been me initiating a relationship with them. Being interested in their life. Find out who they are. Listening. Talking. Telling my story. You know, like we make it such a big thing sometimes, and it's just tell people your story. We all have a story. Just tell them. Tell them how you met this guy named Jesus. People respond to love. And that's the mandate God has given us. So here at Cheers, our first thing is connecting people. Second part of our mission statement is encountering God. We've always believed that people need an encounter, that people need a personal experience with God, that we're called to be more than just a club, we're called to more than do just good works, that we are more than about presenting good theology or sound intellectual arguments. People need an encounter. They need an experience with God. They need to meet this God of love, so they need to feel that love. They need to meet the God of peace, so they need to feel that peace. They need to meet the God of power, so they need to feel that power. And again, we find this in the Bible time after time. In every story, there's an encounter with God that sets the course of someone's life. In 1 Corinthians 2, verse 4 and 6, Paul speaking again, my message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. That your faith would not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. It's about encountering that power. It can't just be an intellectual response. It has to come from a place of encounter. See, the reality is anything that can be won with the mind can be lost with the mind. What I mean by this is if you can be talked into anything, then you can be talked out of anything. If someone can come along with their words and persuade you, you know what, Jesus, and it's all real, and you should do this, and if someone can talk you into it, then someone else can come along with another persuasive word and talk you out of it. But when you encounter God, when you have an experience with God, no one can take that away. The Bible says it like this in John John 3, verse 5 and 7, Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying this. You must be born again." Jesus himself said, you have to have an encounter. It's your spirit that gives birth. It's the Spirit that gives birth to spirit. You need to have a moment in your life that you can look back and say, I met God. God became real to me. It's more than beyond some words. It's more than beyond the pages of a book, but as an actual encounter with God. And in the Bible, time and time again, that is what we see. They would have an encounter and it would set the course of their life. They were no longer this. It would change who they were, what they were about, everything. Why? And they could look back and go, because I had this encounter. I met God. And so at Cheers, we so believe in this. And since the beginning of this church, we've always been about, we want to create a place where people can encounter God. I don't want people just to come in and have a good church service. I want people to come in and experience God. I want people to come in and feel God. I want people to come in and know that God is alive. So we want Cheers to continue to be a place where the Spirit is free to reign, where people can move and operate in the gifts of the Spirit, where we encourage, make room for the moving of Spirit, where we demystify the supernatural. And this means that all of us must at times take risks. Step out, be open to being used. Desire, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14:1, follow the way of love and eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. We have to want it. We have to be open to it. We have to say, you know what, this is important to us and that we're going to create a place for this. And it starts at a personal level that you would come with an expectation in your heart that you would say, you know what, God, I don't always understand everything. I don't always know everything about how you are and how you operate, but God, I'm just open. I'm open to being used. I'm open to you showing yourself to me. I'm open to having an experience with you, that there would just be an openness. If you're going to be part of Cheers, that there would be an openness that you would have to say, okay, God, I don't have all the answers, but I'm just open. I don't know how it always needs to look, but I'm just open. I can't figure everything out, but I'm just open. That needs to be a key to who we are as a church. Because I know even for myself, so many of my experiences with God have come from times where I've just said, okay, I surrender. I surrender my mindsets of what I think it needs to look like, my understanding of who you are. Like, I just surrender because, you know what, my understanding of God is so limited. I believe a big part of encounters is being okay with not always having control, not always knowing what to do. Again, that awkward thing. God just loves, I believe God just, he moves in the place of awkwardness. Because the reality is anything new is always uncomfortable at first. Anything that you ever do new, it's uncomfortable because you're new at it. You don't know how to do it. It doesn't matter if you're framing a wall or you know, it's uncomfortable because it's not natural, because it's new. So I don't know why in the church we always expect everything of God, every move of God to be comfortable to us. And then we like limit God to, well, this is what I'm comfortable with. This is what I know. See, we can't expect God to do a new thing in our lives if we're trying to confine him to our comfort zone. You can't. You have to say, okay, God, it's you. You're God. You're in control. And let me be straight here with you. It's not always about yelling or shaking. I think that's kind of, we get a bit of a hang up sometimes. Oh, you know, if this is what a move of God looks like. This is, you know, it's got to be all weird. And yeah, sometimes it is weird. But you know, it's not always about some weird experience. The story of Elijah, 1 Kings. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. And you know, sometimes God appears in the fire. I've met God in the fire. But sometimes it's just the gentle whisper. And what I'm saying is, it's never about the form that God chooses to operate in. It's about the encounter that we must seek. You got to get beyond just trying to put God in a box, whatever kind of box it is, that he has to speak in a certain way. Don't allow your preference or your expectation of what encounter should look like cause you to hinder and miss the encounter. And the cool thing is, God wants to encounter you. God wants to meet with you. And I believe as we together have an openness, have an expectation, a hunger for God beyond just showing up as part of the routine of our lives, God would break through. You know, we often talk about breakthrough like it's something we have to do. But I've been thinking about this a lot, how God wants to break through to you. It's about what he will do. So together we can create an atmosphere where God is welcome, where God is experienced, where God is felt. The third part of our mission of Cheers is we want to be a place that declares destiny. When you look at Jesus, what always gets to me is how people wanted to follow him. You know, like in our society and day and age, you know, it's like you kind of put any kind of Christian symbol on anything and people are like, oh, you know, they reject it. They don't want anything to do with it. Yet here was Jesus. He is what Christianity is, and people wanted to follow him. The Bible talks about how sinners wanted to come around him. I find that fascinating. And the thing is, often it was like everyday, hardworking, no-nonsense, tough guys, like fishermen, who would leave everything they had ever known to follow Jesus. I find that so remarkable. Like these guys, you know, they weren't young 20-somethings trying to find themselves. You know, get a backpack and go around Europe. Like these were guys that were established with responsibilities and families. They had jobs. And yet they would leave all to follow this guy that they just encountered. This really speaks to me, the power of destiny. If you look at the story in Matthew 4:18, it says, as Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. What did Jesus do here? Don't worry, I'm going to give you the answer. He declared destiny. He called them to be fishers of men. They were doing the one thing they'd always known, what they were comfortable with, what they were trained for. And along comes Jesus, and he sees more in them. Even more than they knew for themselves, more than they could imagine or dream of. He saw beyond where they were. He saw their potential, and it changed everything. These simple, no-name commoners went on to change the world. I fully believe that we are to be a church that declares destiny over people. That we would see beyond where people are. We would see beyond the brokenness of their lives. We'd see beyond the mundane of their existence. That we would see for people even what they can't see for themselves. Like, this is a great thing. This alone is a worthy mission. That we would see someone and we say, you know what? There's something in them. There's something good in them. There's something worth fighting for in them. There's something in them that is of God. That we would see beyond all the distraction of their life and see, no, there's Jesus in them. That's good. There's life in them. There's hope for them. There is something that God would bring forth out of them. And I fully believe as Christians, period, that our job is to declare destiny. In a world that is floundering, in a world that is lost, in a world that doesn't know if it's up or down, left or right, that doesn't have no real concept of where they're going or what they're about, that we would come along saying, you know what? I see Jesus, and there's something in you, and there's something greater about you. And if you just open your heart and open your mind, that God would come in and pull all these things out. But it starts with us as we would go and see beyond where they're at. See the purpose of life. See the promise of life. See the potential of life. And not just stop with seeing it, but declaring it. And the truth is, you don't have to be a great, incredible prophet to declare destiny. No. All of you, all you have to do is declare the promises of God. The Bible is a prophetic book. We are a prophetic people. So tell them. Tell them they have value. 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into wonderful light. Tell them they have purpose. Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Tell them they are loved. 1 John 4:10 and 11, this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. Tell them they are free. John 8:36 says, so if the Son set you free, you'll be free indeed. Like you, that's yours to give. That's yours to declare. You don't have to have, you know, you don't have to be able to be so prophetic that you know their birth date and their favorite pet that died when they're 6 years old for somehow for it to be God. It's a prophetic book. So when you start to declare the book, the word of God, the word of life over them, you are moving in the prophetic. You are declaring life. You're declaring what is there. You are speaking prophetically. You know, sometimes we think it's all this mystical stuff, and it's like, I gotta hear from, you know, God's gotta give me their birth date of their third cousin, and like, no, it's just declare, speak it out. Find a promise, find any promise in that book, and go around just declare that one promise. That's all you have to do, that'll change people's lives. Speak that one promise. And that will ignite, because you know why? It's spirit gives birth to spirit. It's not about you anyways. It's spirit gives birth to spirit. The word of God will bring forth the revelation to their mind and to their heart. And it'll bring life to them. Declare destiny. Declare destiny. God has given you a voice to use, so use it. Like, it's great to be all loving. It's great to be a person of integrity, to show people by your actions who you are. That needs to be done. That's good. But at some point, you have to open your mouth and declare what God has done. You know, there's that famous quote that says, preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words. It is necessary. You know what, because, you know, as famous as that quote is, and as good as it is, the Bible says this in Romans 10:14, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? How can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? There's a point where you have to step up to the plate and you have to speak it out and you have to declare it. And God has given you a voice that you need to use it. People are looking for destiny. I fully believe that. And God has given us a mandate to release destiny over people. Melissa, why don't I have you come up back to the world? So here at Cheers, we want to be about connecting people. We want to be about encountering God. And we want to be about declaring destiny. It's simple. It doesn't have to be all mystical or thing. But I fully believe that if, as we keep this at the forefront of who we are and we seek to operate out of this and just really, this is who we are, this is our mission. If we would all be on board, that we will see those around us come into their destiny, come into their freedom, to meet the God of love and goodness and mercy and grace. This morning, I just want to give an opportunity for prayer. I mean, as I said, you know, encountering God doesn't have to look a certain way, but there is something very powerful about when we come together as a body and we just have an openness and surrenderedness. And so this morning, if you just desire to encounter God afresh and anew, and you just need someone to just come along and prophetically speak into your life, then I just want to give the opportunity. Why don't you stand as Melissa leads us in singing? If that's you this morning, you just feel free to make your way up here, and we'll have some people pray with you and just declare God's goodness. Amen.